Hello friends, welcome to my channel, and today we are going to discuss about the blood supply of the brain, and in that we will discuss about the arterial supply in detail. So before going into this topic, please go through the video on the introduction to the cerebrum, and here we are seeing the pair of heart with the brain. So brain weighs around the 2% of the body weight, but it takes 20% of the blood supply, because brain is the most important organ you have according to your brain, isn't it? So let us see the arterial supply under the following headings. So first we will see overview of the blood supply of the brain, and we will see two systems, carotid and vertebral. In carotid system we see internal carotid artery, anterior and middle cerebral artery. In the vertebro-basilar system we discuss posterior cerebral artery in detail, along with the blood supply of the brainstem and cerebellum in brief. Lastly, the circle of Willis. So the entire brain is supplied by the two arterial system, which belongs to carotid and vertebral system. In the carotid system we see internal carotid artery, in the vertebro-basilar system we see vertebral artery and basilar artery. And when you see the arterial tree supplying the brain, it looks like this. You can see anteriorly you will see pair of internal carotid arteries, posteriorly pair of vertebral arteries which join to form one basilar artery, and these two systems communicate at the base of the brain via circle of Willis. They form arterial anastomosis, which is called as circle of Willis. And here in this animation you are going to see the entire arterial branches supplying the different parts of the brain, that is cerebrum. You can see cerebrum, cerebellum, and different parts of the brainstem. You can see how the brain is supplied by the arterial branches. And when you zoom here, you can see the two arteries, that is right internal carotid artery and left internal carotid artery on this side. Internal carotid arteries are the branches of the common carotid artery at the level of superior border of third cartilage in the neck, and that is basilar artery supplying the most of the pons and midbrain, and pair of vertebral artery supplying most of the spinal cord and medulla. It supplies the upper part of spinal cord and most of the medulla. So these arterial systems supply the entire brain, that is cerebrum, cerebellum, and brainstem. First we will see the carotid system. It involves internal carotid arteries. As I already told you, they come from common carotid artery and enter the middle canal fossa via carotid canal, and opens up into the cavernous sinus by passing through petrous bone and foramen lacerum. You can see the common, this is the internal carotid artery lying posteromedial to external carotid artery. It enters the skull via carotid canal, lies in the petrous part of temporal bone, then comes in the cavernous part, and lastly it forms a siphon or a bend called as carotid siphon. So it reaches on the side of the body of sphenoid and goes through cavernous sinus, and lastly lies lateral to optic chiasma. Its course has follows series of bends called as the carotid siphon. You can see here in the angiography different segments here: cervical part, petrous part, cavernous part, and cerebral part or supraclinoid part. So you can see the different parts of the internal carotid artery during its course: cervical, petrous within the petrous temporal bone, and that is cavernous part where it forms a siphon there, that is cerebral part, also called as supraclinoid part, where it lies lateral to optic chiasma, giving rise to different branches throughout its course. So we can divide into four segments: cervical, petrous, cavernous, supraclinoid, or cerebral segments. Four segments are there through its course, and lastly it gives five terminal branches. You can see in the angiography the course of internal carotid artery. cervical segment, it ascends posteromedial to external carotid artery, enters the carotid canal in the base of the skull. It doesn't give any branches. Petrous segment, it ascends briefly in the carotid canal, bends anteromedially, lies horizontally in the petrous bone, and exits near the posterior part of the foramen lacerum, giving two branches here, corticotympanic branches and pterygoid branches. And cavernous segment, it passes through the cavernous sinus and it moves upwards and medially between the anterior clenoid process and middle clenoid process, giving rise to superior and inferior hypophyseal artery, cavernous rami to the trigeminal ganglia and the cavernous sinus tributaries. You can see there the internal carotid artery is passing through the cavernous sinus. Abducens nerves lies infralateral to it. Coming to the supraclenoid segment or cerebral segment, it gives 5 terminal branches. You can remember them as OPAMA, OPAMA, ophthalmic, posterior communicating, anterochoroidal, and 2 cerebral arteries, middle and anterior cerebral arteries. So ophthalmic artery is there, which supplies the orbit and extraocular muscles. Posterior communicating artery, which communicates the carotid artery to the vertebral system. And anterochoroidal artery, it forms the choroid plexus of the ventricles. Middle cerebral artery supplies most of the brain, most of the cerebrum. Anterocerebral artery also supplies the cerebrum. So these are the 5 terminal branches of internal carotid artery. As you can see here, we will see again in the animation, we are seeing left sided internal carotid artery. You can see how it takes origin from the common carotid artery at the level of superior border of thyroid cartilage, that is there, and it lies posteromedial to external carotid artery. How it enters the skull? Via carotid canal, then lies in the petrous temporal bone horizontally, then opens into the middle canal fossa through the posterior wall of foramen lacerum, cavernous part, then lastly the cerebral part or supraclenoid part. 4 parts are there. You can again visualize the entire course of the internal carotid artery here. That is the entire course of left internal carotid artery. You can see enters the skull via carotid canal, lies in the petrous bone, opens into the middle canal fossa by passing through posterior part of foramen lacerum, and enters into the cavernous sinus, then lastly comes out of cavernous sinus lateral to optic chiasma, forms a cerebral part, giving 5 terminal branches. You can visualize here, you can see we have faded the petrous bone here. You can see the course, that is the petrous course, and that is carotid siphon there. And pulsation of internal carotid artery helps in the movement of the blood in cavernous sinus, that is optic chiasma, and it gives 5 terminal branches, that is the posterior communicating, ophthalmic, middle cerebral, and here posteriorly it gives anterochoroidal branch, and also the anterior cerebral artery is there. So these are the 5 branches of the internal carotid artery within the cerebrum. You can see, and you can notice here, you are seeing the right lateral view of the cavernous sinus containing the carotid siphon here. Section, you can see that is the internal carotid artery. Posteriorly, you are seeing the brainstem, pons, and midbrain, and superior cerebellar arteries, basilar artery there. And here you can notice how the internal carotid artery is there. Optic nerve with optic chiasma, laterally oculomotor nerve, ophthalmic division, abducens, and maxillary mandibular nerves. So this is the carotid siphon, what you see in the right lateral view. Coming to the vertebro basilar system, it is formed by vertebral arteries and basilar artery. Vertebral artery, it arises from the first part of the subclavian artery, ascends through the foramen transversum of the upper 6 cervical vertebra, enters the cranial cavity via foramen magnum, and it also has 4 parts during its course. So vertebral artery is a branch of subclavian artery in 95% of cases, whereas Sometimes the left vertebral artery directly arises from the aortic arch in 5% of cases. What are the four parts? Prevertebral segment, it is there, it lies in the sclerovertebral triangle. Then cervical segment, it enters the transformina of the upper six cervical vertebra and gives the anterior meningeal artery. Atlantic segment, it lies in the suboccipital triangle, it exits the transformina of atlas till it pierces the dura of the enter the cranial cavity, and lastly it enter the cranial cavity via foramen magnum. That is the fourth part. So first part lies in the sclerovertebral triangle, second part in the vertebrae, third part in the suboccipital triangle, fourth part within the cranial cavity. Again you can notice here it's coming from the subclavian artery. First part, second part, third part lies in the suboccipital triangle, fourth part lies in the foramen magnum, where it joins with the another vertebral artery to form basilar artery. So you can see first part, second part, third part and fourth part. First part do not give any branches, second part gives muscular branches there, and along its course it gives number of branches, and most important, supplying the spinal cord are anterior and posterior spinal artery, which also supply medulla along with spinal cord, and its largest branch is posterior inferior cerebellar artery, which supplies the inferior aspect of the cerebellum, and it ascends anteriorly plus laterally around the medulla to reach the midline at the pontomedullar junction and forms basilar artery with the other vertebral artery, and it gives rise to these three branches here. Remember three branches, and that is the vertebral artery you are seeing upside down. You are seeing this diagram upside down. So you can see vertebral artery giving anterior spinal, posterior spinal and posterior inferior cerebellar, and both vertebral artery joined to form basilar artery. I told you are seeing this diagram upside down, and here you can again notice the vertebral artery and its branches. You can see it is giving anterior spinal artery, supplying the spinal cord and a pair of posterior spinal artery and also posterior inferior cerebellar artery. These supply the upper part of spinal cord and medulla, and when you see here in this animation, the vertebral artery is highlighted there. You can see how it is taking origin from the first part of subclavian artery. On the right side is a branch of brachiocephal trunk, on the left side subclavian artery is a branch of arch of aorta. You can see the vertebral artery course. First it has a prevertebral course in the sclerovertebral triangle, then vertebral course or cervical segment within the foramen transverse cerebrum of the upper six cervical vertebra. Third part lies within the suboccipital triangle, fourth part within the cranial cavity. Both side vertebral artery joint to form basilar artery, which lies in the sulcus basilaris of the pons. You can see here it is giving rise to these branches, that is posterior inferior cerebellar artery, that is there, and that is anterior spinal artery, and you can see sometimes the posterior spinal artery comes from the posterior inferior cerebellar artery itself. Sometimes the posterior spinal artery takes the origin from posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So these are the branches of the vertebral artery, and next we'll move on to basilar artery. As you already know, basilar artery is a continuation of both the vertebral arteries at the pontomedullar junction, and at a junction it gives rise to these branches, pontine branches, supracerebellar artery and postcerebellar artery. What are the branches of basilar artery? Pontine artery supplying the pons, and anterior inferior cerebellar artery, as the name suggests, it supplies the anterior and inferior aspect of the cerebellum, and it also gives the two terminal branches, that is superior cerebellar and posterior cerebral. Here you can see the branches here, anterior inferior, pontine, superior cerebellar and posterior cerebral artery. It also gives the labyrinthine artery, which supplies the inner ear, the labyrinth. Superior cerebellar, as the name suggests, it supplies superior aspect. Here you can see the labyrinthine branch coming from basilar artery, and lastly it gives posterior cerebral artery, which supplies the posterior part of the cerebrum. which curves around the midbrain to supply the visual cortex in the occipital lobe, and inframedial aspect of the temporal lobe involving the olfactory regions. So you can see here in this animation, you can see the basilar artery there, formed by the two vertebral arteries that is there lying in the sulcus basilaris of this pons, and you will see the branches here. It gives rise to first branch, that is anterior inferior cerebellar artery supplying the respective part of the cerebellum, and you can see the pons behind it. These are pair of anterior inferior cerebellar arteries, and next it supplies the pons via pontine branches. You can see there, that is pons, left of pons, pontine branches, and near junction with the midbrain it gives rise to superior cerebellar arteries, and lastly posterior cerebral arteries. So it gives anterior inferior cerebellar, pontine, superior cerebellar and posterior cerebral arteries, and labyrinthine artery sometimes takes origin directly from this anterior inferior cerebellar artery. You can notice the labyrinth there, inner ear is supported by a small branch coming from this anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and the most of the brainstem cerebellum are supplied by the vertebrobasal system, including the occipital lobe of the cerebrum. And again in this specimen you can see there vertebral and basilar arteries. You can notice there, and this basilar artery formed by right and left vertebral arteries. It gives rise to these branches, anterior inferior cerebellar, pontine branches are there, perforating arteries they are called as, and lastly superior cerebellar and pair of posterior cerebral arteries. These are the branches of basilar artery. So the internal carotid system and vertebrobasal system are joined by the thin vessels called as posterior communicating arteries. They pass rostrocaudally between the ends of postcerebral and internal carotid artery. So they act as communicator between the two systems. You can see there posterior communicating artery is joining there. And coming to the arterial supply of the cerebrum, it is supplied by the three cerebral arteries, anterior, middle and posterior. So anterior and middle are coming from the internal carotid artery, posterior cerebral from the basilar artery, and they give three types of branches: cortical branches which supply the cortex and some part of white matter, central branches which supply subcortical gray matter, and choroidal branches which form the choroidal plexus within the ventricular system. So each artery will give three branches, all may not, but most of them give three branches. Antecerebral artery we will discuss under the following headings: origin, course, branches and area of the cerebrum supplied. So as you already know, antecerebral artery is a branch of internal carotid artery, one of the terminal branches, and it runs forwards and medially along the medial surface of the brain, curving around the curvature of the corpus callosum. So please go through the surface of the cerebrum before you see this video. You can see there antecerebral artery giving the orbitofrontal branch, frontopolar branch, pericallosal branch and callosomarginal branch. So it supplies most of the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere. You can see this is the branching pattern and area supplied by the anterior cerebral artery. What are the branches? Orbitofrontal artery, frontopolar, callosomarginal and pericallosal artery. It supplies the anterior tutor of the medial cerebral surface and also along the convexity of the cerebral hemisphere. So you can see the branches and the territories. Orbitofrontal surface is supported by the orbitofrontal artery, frontal pole by the frontopolar artery, cingulate and superior frontal gyri by the callosomarginal, and corpus callosum is by the pericallosal branch. Again, you are seeing the medial surface of the right cerebral hemisphere with the different branches of the anterior cerebral artery. Anterior cerebral artery supplies anterior total of the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere, including the 1 cm supramedial strip of the supralateral surface. Here you can see in this section we have removed the left cerebral hemisphere. You are seeing the right cerebral hemisphere, that is the internal carotid artery giving rise to these terminal branches. One of the terminal branches, this anterior cerebral artery, you can see there, that is, now you will highlight that, that is anterior cerebral artery, you can see, that is the anterior cerebral artery running anteromedially and runs along the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere, curving around the corpus callosum, and it gives rise to different branches. You can see here, that is the left anterior cerebral artery you are seeing, and here you can see, that is the orbito frontal artery, and if you notice here, that is the right anterior cerebral coming from this internal carotid artery and giving rise to these branches here. So what are the branches here? First it gives this orbitofrontal artery, medial orbitofrontal artery supplying the medial part of the orbital surface, then frontopolar artery supplying frontal pole, then that is callosum marginal artery supplying the cingulate gyrus, and that is pericallosal artery supplying the corpus callosum, including the this genu and body of the corpus callosum. These are the cortical branches, and you can see this is the central branch, medial striate branch supplying the subcortical gray matter, you know, in the corpus striatum. And you can see the anterior communicating artery there between two anterior cerebral arteries, that is anterior communicating artery. In this specimen you can see how this anterior cerebral artery is curving around the corpus callosum. You can notice there, that is anterior cerebral artery, orbitofrontal artery, and that is frontopolar branch, pericallosal and callosum marginal branches. You can see supplying the genu body of the corpus callosum. You will see septum pellucidum below it, fornix and lamina terminalis. Just in front of that, anterior cerebral artery takes the origin. And this is a picture showing the area supplied by the anterior cerebral artery. It supplies the anterior 2/3 of the medial surface and also 1 cm along the supramedial convexity of the supralateral surface. So this is the area supplied by the anterior cerebral artery. This is the inferior surface showing the medial half of the orbital surface is supplied by anterior cerebral artery via medial orbitofrontal branch. And you can divide the areas, the frontal lobe, the motor area, in the parietal lobe, sensory area involving lower limb and perineum, that is paracentral lobule, are supplied by the anterior cerebral artery. So it also gives central branches which supplies the parts of internal capsule, putamen, globus pallidus, you can notice there. So that is the area of supply of the anterior cerebral artery. You can see in this series of coronal section how the anterior cerebral artery affects the different parts of the cerebrum. Now coming to the middle cerebral artery, it's the largest branch of the internal carotid artery, lies lateral to optic chiasma, and it passes horizontally in the lateral direction to enter the lateral sulcus or sylvian fissure, divides into different branches. It supplies the lateral part of the cerebrum, insula, and also that part of temporal lobe. You can notice here how the middle cerebral artery is running in the lateral sulcus, separating the frontal lobe from the temporal lobe, and runs within the this supralateral surface. In the, if you separate this operculum, you can see that middle cerebral artery giving lateral orbital frontal branch, anterotemporal, posterior temporal, pre-Rolandic, Rolandic artery, and parietal branches, lastly angular branches. So it supplies most of the lateral surface. So middle cerebral artery is the largest branch of the internal carotid artery, runs along the lateral sulcus, comes to the supralateral surface, giving the different branches. It divides into upper division and lower division. It also gives some central branches here. You can see medial striate branch and lateral striate branch, supplying the different parts of the basal ganglia there. And internal capsule, you can see in this animation, we are going to appreciate the origin and supply of the middle cerebral artery, that is the internal carotid artery, left internal carotid artery. You can see there now, that is the middle cerebral artery. This is the middle cerebral artery running in the lateral sulcus, and near the stem of the lateral sulcus, it divides into upper division and lower division. Lower division gives temporal branches, upper division gives the frontal and parietal branches. Remember that. You can see there. Yeah, that is the prefrontal artery, that is the precentral artery. You can see Rolandic artery, anterolandic, and this is the Rolandic artery along the central sulcus. That is post-Rolandic artery. And you can see anterotemporal, middle temporal, and posterior temporal arteries. This is the parietal artery, that is angular artery, that is parietal artery. So these are the different branches on the supralateral surface. You can see here, if you fade the cerebrum, you can see the branching pattern of the middle cerebral artery. So it supplies most of the supralateral surface of the cerebrum, except along the supramedial border, separated by antecerebral artery, and also posterior one third here, which is separated by posterior cerebral artery. So these are the branches, different branches. Okay, so coming from the stem, it gives frontobasal artery or orbitofrontal artery, temporal artery. From the upper division, you will see prefrontal, precentral, central, postcentral, and parietal branches. And from the lower division, you will see middle temporal and angular branches. I told you it runs along the lateral sulcus. Near the stem, it divides into two divisions, upper and lower. And in this picture, you can see the different motor and sensory areas supplied by the middle cerebral artery. So the table depicts you the areas supplied by the middle cerebral artery in different lobes. In the frontal, it supplies motor and motor speech areas. In the parietal lobe, sensory and sensory speech areas, except paracentral lobule, that is by the antecerebral artery. And in the temporal lobe, it supplies the auditory area. So any occlusion or hemorrhage of the middle cerebral artery has devastating consequences. And here you can see only anterior part of temporal lobe is supplied by the middle cerebral artery and the medial view. And in this picture, you can see the central branches. It is giving the striate branches to the lentiform nucleus, caudate nucleus, anterior and posterior limbs of the internal capsule. You can see the lateral striate branches supplying the globus pallidus there. And this is the angiographic view showing the branches of middle cerebral artery. And here, this is the supralateral surface. You can see the predominant area is supplied by the middle cerebral artery, except along the supramedial border and infralateral border. Coronal images showing the area of supply of middle cerebral artery. So compared to antecerebral, middle cerebral has more area of supply. Moving to the posterior cerebral artery, as you know, it comes from the vertebrobasal system. It is a branch of the basilar artery. Sometimes it is a direct continuation of posterior communicating artery. It lies within this interpeduncular fossa, then runs along the medial surface there. You can see postcerebral artery supplying the posterior part of the cerebrum, giving numerous cortical, choroidal and central branches. You can see there, it supplies the occipital lobe, that is posterior one third of the medial surface. You can see it gives following arteries. It gives two branches, lateral and medial branches. Lateral branch gives antetemporal, posterior temporal and occipitotemporal branches. Medial gives calcarine, parieto-occipital and callosal branches, supplying the respective parts of the medial and lateral parts of the occipital lobe. You can see. So you should remember, posterior cerebral artery mainly supplies the midbrain and occipital lobe along with the some parts of the brainstem. That is midbrain, you can see here, and the medial branches here. That is posterior cerebral artery giving the medial branches, anterior and posterior temporal artery, that is calcarine artery and parieto-occipital artery. So these all come from medial part. And here in this animation, you can see how it gives. Posterior cerebral artery come from the bifurcation of the Bessler artery. And here, if you turn and see, if you go to the posterior part of the cerebrum, you can visualize the artery there, which is highlighted. That is posterior cerebral artery. It gives two branches, two sets of branches, medial and lateral occipitotemporal arteries. Medial side again gives temporal, calcarine and parieto-occipital branches. You can see here, that is the posterior cerebral artery. This is the lateral branch, that is the medial branch. Lateral will give again temporal branches supplying the part of the superolateral surface along infralateral border. The medial artery gives three sets of branches, temporal, parieto-occipital and calcarine. And not only that, you can see these are the parts supported by posterior cerebral. Not only these cortical branches, it also gives central branches which divide into posterolateral and posteromedial group. Posteromedial group supplies hypothalamus and globus pallidus via thalamoperforating arteries, whereas the posterolateral group will be there. It supplies via thalamogeniculate artery. It also supplies cerebral peduncle and tectum of the midbrain. So don't think posterior cerebral artery supplies only cerebrum. It also supplies some part of midbrain. So you can see the area of supply of the posterior cerebral artery. It supplies posterior one third of the medial surface and also supplies the superolateral surface along the infralateral border and posterior part of superior medial border. And areas in the occipital lobe, it supplies visual area, and in the temporal lobe, it supplies olfactory area. So here is the table comparing the distribution of the three cerebral arteries. Anterior and middle come from internal carotid, posterior from the Bessler. Anterior related to callosal sulcus, middle to the lateral sulcus, posterior to the calcarine sulcus. You can see the branches there. Posterior cerebral artery also gives choroidal branch, that you should remember. And this is the coronal section image showing the distribution of the posterior cerebral artery. Here you can see anterior cerebral artery supplies the medial surface, middle cerebral artery the lateral surface, and posterior cerebral artery the inframedial part of the temporal lobe. Here in this picture we can summarize the cerebral arteries. You can see there, that is the, you can see here, that is the middle cerebral artery supplying. This is the antecerebral along the supromedial border convexity. The entire lateral surface, most of it is predominantly by the, this is by the middle cerebral artery. And occipital lobe is by the posterior cerebral artery. So this is the summary you can see on the superolateral surface. And coming to the arterial anastomosis of the brain, circle of Willis, where both the systems meet, you can see here, they form a pentagonal arterial anastomosis. You can see in the base of the brain, in the interpeduncular fossa, where two systems supplying the cerebrum meet. You can see here, and in this picture the circle of Willis is formed by this anterocommunicating artery anteriorly, anterolaterally by the antecerebral artery, laterally by the internal carotid, posterolaterally by the posterior communicating, and posteriorly by the posterior cerebral artery coming from basilar artery. So it's a, you can say, pentagonal or hexagonal arrangement. You can see anteriorly by the anterior communicating branch of antecerebral, anterolaterally by the antecerebral artery, laterally by the internal carotid, and posterolaterally by the posterior communicating artery, and posteriorly by the posterior cerebral artery coming as a bifurcation of the basilar artery. In this picture you are seeing the arterial system in the base of the interior of the cranium around the optic chiasma. There you can see, if you go from posterior to anterior, here you can see that is the internal carotid artery on the lateral side of the optic chiasma, posterior cerebral artery coming from basilar artery. You can also see superior cerebellar arteries. So if you see the formation of circle of Willis, anteriorly anterior communicating, anterolaterally you are seeing anterocerebral, laterally by the internal carotid artery and also part of middle cerebral artery, posterolaterally by the posterior communicating, and posteriorly by the posterior cerebral artery. So this arterial circle maintain the equal distribution of the blood flow to the both the hemispheres. You can see in the base of brain how they form the anastomosis. So friends, this is about the areas supplied by the arteries. Here you can see corpus striatum and internal capsule, they are majority supplied by the anterior and middle cerebral arteries, thalamus by the basilar and posterior cerebral arteries, even the midbrain, pons by the basilar branches, medulla oblongata by the vertebral artery, that is vertebral artery, posterior inferior cerebral artery, anterior inferior cerebellar artery, cerebellum via three sets of cerebellar arteries. Hope you liked it. Please go through it, like and comment, and don't forget to subscribe. And thanks for watching. Thanks for your time and patience. Please provide your genuine feedback to improve further. Thank you.